here we've seen many top U.S. banks buying into the top five Chinese financial institutions. Are you quite surprised that now the tables have been turned and it's possibly a Chinese bank, CCB, buying into Bear Stearns?
It's not to anyone's surprise, because last year we see Unocal trying, senior wanted to buy Unocal. And looking over the past 2 years or 3 years, we see revamps in the financial industry in China. Last year, for example, you know, the housekeeping, non-tradable shares, we make tradable, and this is one big step. And today there are news that the Chinese banks in China are allowed to convert renminbi and buy into foreign currencies to acquire fixed income products overseas. Now, this is natural development as the country grows, and what China is in need now is a healthy financial market. And now let's look into the investment banking business. Now, investment banking business, there's no size to this business, all right? It's all about relationship, distributions, and credentials. So there are so many IPOs lying up, big companies, I'm talking about state-owned enterprises, to be listed, whether it's Shanghai or Hong Kong or NASDAQ. So it's a natural move that big banks like Construction Bank of China, and maybe later on I might foresee that ICBC Bank, Industrial Commercial Bank of China, Bank of China, or even Agriculture Bank, you know, with the big IPO funds, they need to, in order to build IB, which is investment banking business, they need to acquire a branded kind of banks.
As you say, that China's financial markets is indeed very buoyant, and we may see these financial institutions looking outside for new investments. You particularly mentioned Sinok, who aggressively wanted to buy Unocal in the United States last year, but failed. So are we likely to see then a company like China Construction Bank, who is although denying the report that they want to buy into Bear Stearns, fail in its bid for this U.S. investment bank?
But oil business is more sensitive, it's more strategic. But when it comes to acquiring maybe a financial institutions, there are a few hundred picks for Chinese banks. So it's not as sensitive as oil business.
Yeah.
And acquiring to convertible bonds is one way. You know, and there's too much fun simply sitting in China.
So you don't see any regulatory hurdle here? And this eventually, if confirmed by China, will be a success? Will be a successful deal between China Construction Bank and Bear Stearns, you think?
I strongly believe businesses, businessmen in America, even the banks. Now, for example, if Bear Stearns acquired, they give them a jump start to do bigger deals in China, the IPOs, for example. So this is good for American business.
So do you think that Chinese banks are only interested in American banks, or would they also be interested in the European and Asian banking
industry? Of course. But again, the biggest market and the best picks still has to be in the U.S. Of course, if you look at the British banking, Barings is gone. ING bought it. Deutsche Bank bought the Morgan Grenfell 10, 15 years ago. And, you know, even Drexel Bankworth was gone, you know, is bought by even a German bank. So, of course, more picks will happen in America. We see the second tier banks. There are quite a number of them that are pretty good picks by Chinese banks.
Do you think all of these press releases, all these announcements, come ahead of President Hu Jintao's visit to the United States to basically appease the United States that China is not basically moving quickly on its currency reform program?
What President Hu could bring on table to President Bush is that, yes, you see, our banks from China are now trying to acquire maybe financial institutions, and they, in a way, might just bring down a bit of the trade imbalance. You know, just imagine last year if Unocal $50 billion deal would happen, you know, then that would reduce the deficits quite substantially. Yes.
Charles Chow of China Knowledge, thank you so much for analysis. Thank you so much for joining us, Charles. First of all, do you think that it is a good move? It is the right timing to resume this equity raising exercise?
If you could recall last year, since the non-tradable shares reforms, and we spoke about 7:30, right after the 9:30 trading, first hour trading, you know, all the four stocks that with the non-tradable issues has broke records over the limits. Now, since the reforms, after a year, we see index has rise about more than 40%. Now, today, the Chinese stocks, not just Shanghai or Shenzhen, even Hong Kong, or stocks listed in Singapore, have tremendous rise in prices, 20-25%. In Hong Kong, we're seeing about 30-40%.
Do you think that these markets that you mentioned, Singapore and Hong Kong, should fear this latest move by Chinese regulatory authorities? Because Chinese companies, domestic companies, will now list in the mainland rather than look to Hong Kong or to Singapore to raise money.
If you look at into the equity market for maybe the 5-7 years, that horizon, it hasn't correlated with the GDP growth of China. All right, stock market going down, but the GDP is keep going up. Now that and also the regulations for listing in the Shenzhen or Shanghai Stock Exchange was primarily giving the emphasis to state-owned enterprises, and that's where we see today we have 100 companies in Singapore Stock Exchange from China listed here, and we have of course hundreds of companies, mainly the big ones listed in Hong Kong, and even some very good quality stocks are listed in Nasdaq, some in London Stock Exchange,
right.
A bit of Zurich, even Tokyo now. Stock exchange are now pitching for listings for Chinese companies in the stock exchange.
So do you think there are still quality companies on the mainland who can list over the next few years? Because most of them, as you mentioned, have already listed in Singapore, Hong Kong, New York, and the London Stock Exchanges.
I heard from analysts in Shanghai and Beijing, the long queue of companies, mainly the so-called private enterprises wanting to list in the Shanghai or Shenzhen, it's a long, long queue. There's a lot of potential.
There's a lot of potential, Charles, as you say, good companies. But according to the China Securities Regulatory Commission website, companies must meet 34 criteria to be eligible to sell stock. And among them, 3 successive years of profit and dividend payments equal to at least 20% of income. Do you think that this long line of companies will be able to meet this criteria?
This is precisely what foreign investors, even local investors, be it people investors or institutional investors, they want to look into profitability. In the past, when you talk about the non-tradable shares, they're not accountable to their not 100% not accountable, but they're not so accountable to the performance. P&L was not in big issues. They want fundraising. Now, the CSR, the so-called China Securities Regulatory Committee, says, I want profitability, I want decent turnover, and then you are qualified for listings.
And now, the most of all, yes, transparency.
Yes, transparency. And then we are also seeing this increasing amount of foreign funds into China, like the QFII, Qualified Foreign Institution Investors.
So Charles, if this
has increased to 40, and now it's $6.3 billion to be in the market.
So briefly, before we let you go, if you say that there are a lot of quality companies in China that could list on the stock market, which sectors are they from?
It all range. It could be manufacturing, services, and also there are positive factors, the so-called A and B shares. And we believe that maybe within this year or next year, there'll be no more A and B shares. That would facilitate foreign investors in the Chinese stock markets.
Charles Chow from China Knowledge Consulting.